reading again.
Good morning and happy Easter weekend. And thank you, Anda. Nice to hear the organ being played so well. Welcome to the Napa Community Seventh-day Adventist Church for a very special weekend. We're here every week, but it's wonderful to celebrate the Easter season. So if you're joining us from home, from wherever you may be online, welcome. And to those of you who are here, welcome. And we hope that today will be a blessing. And hopefully you've already had a blessing of some food. Hopefully. At least we saw a number of you. It was great. So many people helped, and we are very grateful. And it was really nice seeing the pastors becoming experts on flipping pancakes. Yeah, glad you're getting used to it, because it does happen around here several times a year. And for those who helped with the foot washing service, we're very grateful for that option being available as well. We have a walk. There is a walk, I should say, coming up tomorrow. Tell us about it.
Tomorrow morning at 6:30, we will leave the parking lot of Westwood Hills Park, which, as many of you know, is right along First Street or Browns Valley Road as you're heading west into Browns Valley. Will the walk take place? The answer is yes. Will it rain? No. Will you need good shoes? Decent shoes. There might be a little bit of mud right down below, but otherwise the fire road to the top is very passable and not muddy. It takes about 20 minutes to walk up leisurely. You can run up in 12 minutes. Sunrise is scheduled for about 6:55, so that should give us plenty of time to gather together at the top, see that sunrise, and thank God for his son who also rose on Easter morning. We are leaving the parking lot at 6:30, so we encourage you to arrive at the parking lot earlier to put your shoes on or put your jacket on or otherwise say hello to all of us who will be there. We've done this a number of times in years past. It was postponed during the pandemic, and tomorrow we will revive it. And we look forward to seeing each one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Gerhardt. Today is a special day as we will be celebrating communion. We will worship God in all that we do today. Our offering today is for local church mission and ministry. And there is a box in the back if you care to put your offering in there or to give online. We're very grateful for all the support that you give throughout the year. We do have a couple of transfers that will be voted on next week. We have Robert Wayne Johnson joining the Yountville Science Memorial Church in Yountville and Catherine Van Arsdale to the Niles Westside Adventist Church in Niles, Michigan. We'll vote on those next week. But again, welcome. May God truly bless you and touch your heart in a special way this Easter weekend. And I will turn it over to our pastor.
Thank you so much. Happy Sabbath, happy Easter, good morning, Shabbat Shalom. If you're following your bulletin, it's time for invocation. Invocation is going to happen differently this morning. I would like us to have Psalm 19 on screen. Psalm 19 in a versified version. I will be singing that psalm in a language that is not on the screen. And I'm gonna sing it as it was originally made, and the music is done by the famous composer Ludwig van Beethoven. After I will do that first rendering of the song, I would like to invite all of you to stand. So that's after I finish that first stanza. And I will invite you to join singing that time in English, because what I have on screen is a translation of that original poem in English. All right, ready? Yes.
Receive their word. numberless stars in their places. Who bids the sun its light diffuse? He comes with brightness and smiles in our faces, and he
Amen. Please be seated. Isn't music wonderful, even if it's different? Psalm 19 is going to be followed by Psalm 133. 133 from the book of Psalms says, "Behold how good and how pleasant for the brethren to dwell together." I'm sure you know that psalm. But this time we will sing it different. We'll sing it in Hebrew. Did you know you knew how to sing in Hebrew? I have there the first lines of the psalm in Hebrew transliterated. Hine ma tov uma naim. So that's the first line. Hine ma tov uma naim, which is, "Behold how good and how pleasant." Second line, shevet. Do you know what that means? You know the word Shabbat, because I keep saying Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, peace, rest. But Shabbat comes from that verb, shevet, which means to dwell. Shevet achim, which is brothers and sisters, gam yachat, indeed, yachat, like one, or as one, or in oneness, or in unity. Okay? So I would like you to say it with me so your ears get used to it, and then I'm going to start singing. You will be listening, but we will also learn that song together. So, Hine ma tov uma naim shevet achim gam yachat. Excellent. All right. I'm going to sing a first stanza, and then I'll come back with some more explanations.
Hine ma tov uma naim shevet achim gam yachat. Hine ma tov uma naim shevet achim gam yachat. Hine ma tov shevet achim gam yachat. Hine ma tov shevet achim gam yachat.
All right, now comes a very happy segment. And I need you to get ready to join me playing your instruments. You probably know that in the book of Psalms, because we've learned from the book of Psalms throughout the quarter, in the book of Psalms, there is an instrument, the instrument of 10 strings. Have you seen that? That's how they have translated that one word. The one word is asar, which comes from eser, that is 10. But in the original language, it's not 10 strings. It's the instrument of 10. It's the 10. More and more Bible scholars say that's this. That's the instrument of 10. This one. Okay? So I'll leave it up to you to join in when you feel your instrument can fit in. Okay?
Hine matovu manahim shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu manahim shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu manahim shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu Umanahim Shevetahim Gam Yahat.
Wonderful. You kinda got it. All right. We are gonna repeat this part, okay? And then we'll move to another section of it. All right, piano.
Hine matovu manahim shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu manahim shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu manahim shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu Umanahim Shevetahim Gam Yahat.
I said this was the happy part, but you could notice that it has a minor sonority. So it sounds somewhat like it's sad, but still it's happy. Now the following section is a lamentation. What is interesting about it is that it's a lamentation with the same words, same lyrics. So how can you lament and say, Hine matov u manayim shevet achim gam yahat? How can you say that lamenting? You can, especially when you are home, maybe sick, maybe facing some real difficult things, challenges in your life. You would like to be with the brethren, with the brothers and sisters, but you cannot. So you can sing the same lyrics as a lament.
Hine matu Shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matov umanayim. Shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu manahim shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matovu manahim Shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matov umanahim. Shevetahim gam yahat. Hine matov umanahim. Shevetahim gam yahat.
Amen. Somebody came to me at the pancake breakfast and told me, Pastor, I would like to share something special in 5 minutes. And I said, yes, in 1 minute. So John, 1 minute, 60, 59.
A lot of you know Jeannie. And Carl, I've been praying for my girlfriend, my granddaughter. She'd been having seizures when she was a little kid. At 6 months old, she had over 500 seizures. They told her she could not walk or talk. Now she's walking, talking. She's been healed over eight years of no seizures. She's learning how to, she still has some medical problems. But she's doing wonderful. Thanks to all of your prayers.
Amen. Thank you, John. Yeah, that was 1 minute. What's Tamara? Amara. Amara. Excellent. In your bulletins, the next moment is State of the Church Address, March 2024. As of March the 30th, 2024, the Napa Community SDA Church has 1,018 members in the books. As you've probably noticed, I've been doing my best to reach out to you and learn your names. Sorry for the hit and miss. Thank you, pastors. Thank you, elders. Thank you, deacons. Thank you, ministry leaders. Thank you, teachers, for your dedicated leadership. Thank you, special dear volunteers, for being lovely and lively pieces in the colorful mosaic of our church's ministry. And kudos to you, administrative assistants, for masterfully putting those pieces together, coordinating not only church functions, but also the much valued AA meetings. Week after week, community services have been there as hands-on hands and feet of Jesus Christ. We Care Ministries has shared words of affirmation, encouragement, and comfort. Hospitality ministries have flanked us on all sides, welcoming, greeting, guiding, providing both feed and food, literally, including that well-praised Cafe Sabbath, and now also the Easter pancake breakfast. Thank you. Youth and children ministries have been diligently weaving the vibrant tapestry of our church's not only future, but present. Their efforts are combined with the endeavors of our mission and ministry extension, the Napa Christian Campus of Education. By the way, did you attend Napa Christian's stream fair? If you missed it this year, please plan better for next year. The replica of Gustav Kim's Death and Life painted on the face of one of our seniors is still before my eyes. Death and life. That's our experience. The chain of departures got longer again this quarter, boosting even more the longing of our grieving hearts. Grief is an unavoidable and painful existential reality of our church family, a reality we want to take seriously. Therefore, we're looking for volunteers willing and able to take on the leadership of a well-needed grief care ministry. On the happier side, let's celebrate those who joined our family during the last quarter. Ronnie Henry, via baptism, that was my first Sabbath here. Julie Mendy, via transfer. And we have three people that would like to join us through profession of faith. I would read their names, and I would leave it up to you to welcome them the best way possible. John Sheckford, Paula Prito, and Ina Belova. Thank you. Our worship services have grown in attendance. The approximately 200 on-campus in-pew worshipers are at least doubled by online worshipers on couch and in rocking chair. Our YouTube channel has gained close to 200 new subscribers, so we are now just a little shy of 1,000. By God's grace, we aim to provide a feast of God's word every single Sabbath, food and feed. Dear musicians and singers, children's storytellers, and sound and video technicians, your contribution is not a side dish. What you say or sing and what you do are integral and indispensable ingredients of the main dish. Thank you for the time you invest in rehearsals, streaming preparation, stage setup, and other backstage activities. Those too are acts of worship, as important as, if not even more important than, public worship. Relevance is our buzzword. Relevant in time and space. Time, 21st century. Space, the Napa Valley, and all the hills and valleys of the global village. Thank you all, in pew and on couch, or in rocking chair, for your faithfulness in providing the financial means for our ministry. Church finances are crucial. Even more so is stewardship. Stewardship, that is, the ship that makes sure the stew reaches its destination. That's my definition. Thank you, finance department, for being that ship to our church. I can't close my address without emphasizing the shaker and mover of everything, which is prayer. Thank you, prayer ministry. Thank you, prayer warriors. Not warriors, as in not worry, but war. Or rather, thank you, prayer peacemakers. Thank you, prayer shalom makers. My closing remarks, soli Deo Gloria, glory to God alone. Amen. This State of the Church address would be something we would have every fifth Sabbath when we also have communion, as an update and projection of what is intended for the next segment. I would like to invite all our kids to quickly get here to the main aisle. And please watch that miniature rendition of a building that is familiar to you. Do you know that building? That is Napa Christian. Somebody, a member of our church, graciously made that miniature rendition of the main building there. And that's gonna serve from now on as the basket for the education gathering or offering we pick up every Sabbath. Thank you so much.
Hello.
There we go. Come on down, boys and girls. The littles, the bigs, the in-betweens, come on down. Got a few more coming down. Come on down. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Is everybody having a good day? Yes. Is everybody ready for Easter? Maybe get some eggs and some candy and all that good stuff. That'd be fun. Well, today, I first want to start off by reading you guys a memory verse. And it talks about when something bad happens, sometimes good things can happen out of that bad thing. So I'm going to read you a verse from Isaiah 61:3. He will bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, and the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. So about almost a year and a half ago, we had a little goat at our house. Her name is Gremlin. She's kind of a bad little goat. But Gremlin had a baby, or she was going to have a baby. She had a big tummy, and she was eating a lot, and she was making a bunch of noise, and we knew it was almost time. But when it came time for Gremlin to have the baby wasn't alive. And we were so sad, and we thought, oh no, this is just a horrible thing. But then guess what happened? Gremlin was going to have another baby. So just about 3 weeks ago, Gremlin had another baby, and it looked just like the baby that came out last time, but this time it's alive. And this baby is the sweetest thing. He's the nicest goat I have on our farm. And it just goes to show that even though sometimes bad things happen, just in God's time, good things can come around and happen as well. So with that being said, I am going to show you Gremlin's little baby. He's 3 weeks old. He is a half Nigerian pygmy goat and a half boar goat. And we don't have a name for him, but my son is calling him Hopper. We're still undecided on that name. But I will bring him out in just a second.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declare the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to
Thank you so much, Ramona. I appreciate that. That was a wonderful song. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Excuse the mic drop. That was not supposed to happen. I apologize for that. Hope you're all having a wonderful weekend. This is a very sacred weekend in the Christian world. We start off with Good Friday, and then the Sabbath, and then Easter, or Resurrection Day. I think a lot of us think of this weekend in a more lighter sense than what it actually is. Combined with that, with our communion service, this weekend is so sacred and significant in the Bible, in our history as Christians. Millions of people around the world look at this and are wondered with awe and with reverence as to what everything represents. This weekend is about what Jesus did for us and the sacrifices that he gave so that you and I could have eternal life. And so today, as we gather to commemorate communion and Resurrection Day or Easter, I want us to delve into the significance of these observances or holidays or events that happen. Resurrection is the celebration of Jesus' victory over sin. And communion is the remembrance of his sacrifice. Both of these are pivotal moments in our faith that offer us opportunities to remember, reflect, and renew our commitment to Jesus, to remind us as to who we are and why we are here. Let us pray. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you, Lord, for all that you have done for us, Father. Thank you for dying on the cross and coming back to life, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we have the hope that you're going to take us home with you, Father. Thank you for all that you have done for us, Lord, for sending us your one and only Son to save us, a group of imperfect people, imperfect humans, humans full of sin, humans full of lack of a lack of being able to reach you, Lord, people that are fallen. And yet you looked at us, Father, and you wanted us to come home with you. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for giving us a chance, Lord. Thank you for coming down and being and living with us, Father. Thank you for allowing us to know who you are. And thank you for wanting us to be with you, Lord. Please be with us. May we have extra reverence, Lord, more reverence than usual in your house, Lord. And may we be able to reflect on these two holidays or events more significantly than how we look at them. Thank you, Father. Give us your Holy Spirit. And I pray these things in your name. Amen. I want to invite all of you to open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians. We're going to go to chapter 15. And we're going to read verses 3 and 4. First Corinthians 15, verses 3 and 4. It says, "For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures." Amen. I want to give you an illustration as to what that picture looks like. Imagine that scene. There was a garden or a wilderness shrouded in darkness where sorrow and despair once reigned in that area. In this garden, a tomb stands silent, sealed by a heavy stone. Suddenly, early in the morning, at the crack of dawn, the earth trembles and the stone is rolled away. An angel descends, proclaiming with glory, "He is not here. He has risen." The tomb, once a symbol of death, now becomes an empty testament to the victory of life over death. You know, church family, Resurrection Day or Easter reminds us that the power of God transcends any and all obstacles, even death itself. It is a time for us to reflect on the profound love and sacrifice that Jesus did. Jesus willingly laid down his life to redeem us from sin. Let us not recount this as a pure historical event, but My prayer and my wish for all of you today is that we have that personal encounter with the living Christ, the Christ that is alive, the Christ that is in the most holy place, intervening on our behalf, the Christ that we can talk to, we can have an experience with, we can have a walk with. You know, oftentimes, we as Christians, we always think about the cross, right? The cross is the ultimate symbol of who we are. And it is a visual representation of the ultimate sacrifice. But in the cross, we often get lost and forget the resurrection, which is the second part of that story. It is the other major part, the part that isn't as talked about, the part that is sometimes is forgotten. And what I want to remind you all today is that the cross goes with the resurrection. Because although the cross is a symbol of the blood shed by our Savior Jesus Christ, the resurrection is the beautiful hope that you and I can have today. It's a powerful image, the resurrection, for all those who wait upon the Lord to return for a second time, for us who are living, that we wait upon the Lord to return for a second time. I want you to notice a few themes that you can find in the resurrection and the communion accounts. There's three major ones that I think you should all take into consideration. And I don't want you to think of this as a sermon, but more of a reflection. I wanted to invite you to reflect on these things and to think about them. Chew on them, if you will. The first theme is forgiveness and reconciliation. The resurrection message of redemption and the act of communion reminds us of the forgiveness that we have received from Jesus Christ. And as we remember the price that he paid for our sins, we are challenged to extend forgiveness to others, just as he has forgiven us. Resurrection in the communion service reminds us to let go of bitterness, to heal past wounds, and embrace the grace that Jesus has given to us. The second theme is empowerment for service. Just as Jesus' resurrection empowered his disciples to go out and do ministry and to reach those from every corner of the globe, this reminds us to continue that ministry today, to continue to reach out to those people who don't know about the sacrifice and the death of Jesus and the resurrection. As we encounter Christ in communion this morning, may we are filled with his Spirit, and we are equipped to carry that same mission that was originally started from those disciples. One example of that is the foot washing. The foot washing is the ultimate act of humility. You know, back then in the Bible, foot washing was only given to those who were of the lowest of the low. You know, those that were rich had someone at their door ready to wash their feet. Why, you ask? Well, back then, you know, they didn't have shoes like you and I did. You know, people walked thousands of miles in dirt and in sweat. And so foot washing was considered to be the ultimate act of humility, the ultimate act of submission, of service. And look at what Jesus did. He washed his disciples' feet. Just as he said, he has not come here to be served, but to serve others. We should do the same as well. Both resurrection and communion inspire us to be agents of transformation, to bring hope, healing, and compassion to a world that truly needs it most. And the last theme is a theme that you and I can resonate very well with, the anticipation of the second coming of Jesus. Both resurrection and communion point us forward to the ultimate fulfillment of that event, when God's kingdom will once again return in glory. As we remember resurrection and partake in communion, we do so with the anticipation that you and I can see that event happen live in person one day. We will all be reunited as believers in Christ and go home together. This motivates us to continue to push on and know that our labor is not in vain, that there's something bigger and better to come for each and every one of us. Now I want to transition to communion and the significance of communion. I want to invite all of you to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 23. Let us remember the words of the Apostle Paul as we read. And I'm going to read to verse 26. It says, "For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' After the same manner, he took the cup which he had supped, saying, 'This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do it in me, as you remember it in me, and drink it. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you shall show the Lord's death until he comes.'" Picture that scene now. Communion table, the Last Supper, the final meal. A humble table set with the bread and the wine, or grape juice as we call it. Symbols of Christ's body and blood. Around it, believers from all walks of life, from different places around the world. You know, I look at our church. We're a very diverse church. It's beautiful to see. Yet we are all united under the same thing, our love for Christ and our faith in him. As we prepare our hearts to partake in this communion, we are taken back to that same room and that same scene where Jesus shared his final meal. Both of these things remind us of the ultimate sacrifice. In other words, church family, this morning I ask that we don't take communion as lightly as we should. We don't see it as something that is just what we see with our eyes, but we look at the symbols, the bread and the juice or the wine, and remind ourselves, what does this really represent? Who is this really about? What is the significance of this in my life? Communion is not a ritual. It's not something that, you know, we do every once in a while and, oh, okay, you know, we move on. No. It's a moment of intimacy with Jesus. It's a time for us to examine our hearts, confess our sins, and renew our commitment to follow Jesus. Let us remember the depth of Christ's love and the new covenant that we have in him. I hope that as we transition soon to the communion experience, that our faith can be strengthened, that we can be more united as a church, that we can be empowered to live out the teachings that he has given us in his word. As I conclude this short thought, I hope that the power of Resurrection Day or Easter and communion continue to resonate in our hearts and lives. I hope that we can go forth as witnesses of who Jesus is and what he did for us, and that he's coming back. I hope that we can use this experience and renew our commitment, remind ourselves, Jesus, I'm here. I want to be yours. I was lost, but now I am found. May we never forget the significance of the resurrection. Maybe we never forget the significance of communion. May we be reminded of this every time we see these holy symbols. All these are reminders of God's love, his faithfulness, his grace and redemption. And if you haven't had that experience yet, I want to invite you to have that experience with us this morning. Let me pray one more time. Lord, as we transition to communion, Father, I want to ask that you put our hearts and our minds in the right place. May we be prepared. May we be prepared to take on this experience, Father. May we be enlightened by your word and by your spirit. May all of us enjoy this experience. It's an intimate moment with you, Lord. It's a moment where we can look back and remember all the good things that you have done for us. And know that you are coming soon, Father. Know that you are with us. You want to be with us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for dying on the cross for us. Thank you, Father, for your sacrifice, for everything you do for us. Thank you, Lord. We are eternally grateful. Thank you, Father. I pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. And from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight.
So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you who paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope.
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light.
So then you took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, then you walked right out again.
No sting,
oh,
and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb.
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness into glorious light. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood, the blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood, the blood. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood, the blood that calls us sons and daughters.
by our Father through the blood, the blood. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood.
Amen. Amen. It is time now to bring our celebration to its culmination. In front of us, we have symbols of the broken body, sinless broken body, symbolized by unleavened bread. And then we will also have the cups. And in the cup, the symbol of Jesus' blood, sinless blood, therefore unfermented wine. I would like to ask Pastor Jim to give us some guidelines as to how we'll proceed, and then we'll go with that.
Our communion service, which, as Pastor Alex already indicated, every time we celebrate this, we proclaim, we remember, we embrace, and we accept the sacrifice of Jesus until He comes. Our service is open to anyone who proclaims and understands the love of Jesus for their life and His salvation for them. And as we come to the table, we would ask that you come down the center aisle to get the elements of the bread and the juice, and then go back to your seats by one of the side aisles. We'd invite you to come now.
Yes. Gluten-free option is available for those that need that. Thank you. I hope each one of you had a chance to take a piece of unleavened bread and a cup of unfermented wine. I want to appreciate that some of you have taken extra. That means that somebody may be at home, somebody lamenting being together with the brethren. I would like to also say that if you are home and you have some crackers or some grape juice at hand, you can do whatever we are doing here together and join us in this celebration of the sacrifice that brings salvation. At this moment, we will have the reading and the prayer over the emblems. We'll go in the same order we have described in the Bible. First, the bread, and then the wine. Elder Gerhard is going to do the reading and prayer for the bread.
Reading from Matthew chapter 26, verse 26. While they were eating, Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Let us pray. Father, just as Jesus thanked you for that bread many, many years ago, we thank you today, not only for the bread, but for his body that nourishes our hunger. May this bread fortify our characters and our souls, as well as our bodies. We thank you for it. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Continue our scripture reading, and Pastor Alex will read the scripture for the wine and then pray over it.
Matthew 26, verses 27 and 28. It says, "Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.'" Let us pray. Lord, thank you for your blood, Father, for making the ultimate sacrifice to save each and every one of us, Father. Help us to never forget that sacrifice, to remember Calvary, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have shed that blood to save us, to redeem us. And may we not take it lightly, Lord, but are reminded of how much it really took to come down and save us. Bless this juice, Father, and I pray all these things in your name, amen.
Amen. I would like to thank the team of servants that have set up and organized everything so this can be a highlight of our spiritual experience. I would like you to go with a sense of Christ's presence in a very real way in your life. And give everybody the news that at the table, everybody is welcome. You can even tell them we had communion and we even had a goat. So even goats are allowed. Thank you so much for coming out for this special celebration. I would like to say something for those that could not be here. If you would like to be visited by our elders, pastors, to bring communion emblems to your home, that is possible. I promised last week I won't bring pancakes to anybody's house. But if you would like a visit, please let us know, and I will flip a French crepe for you. While I don't know what the limit of the distance should be, but I can say I would go an extra mile. Thank you so much for serving. Thank you so much for being part of this celebration. What else could I say than Hine Matov U Manaim Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat.
Hine Matov Manaim Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat. Hine Matov Manaim Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat. Hine Matov Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat. Hine Matov Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat.
Get your instruments ready.
Hine, hine, hine Matov Manaim Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat. Hine, hine, hine Matov Manaim Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat. Hine Matov Manaim Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat. Hine Matov Manaim Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat.
Amen.
Jesus and his disciples ended their celebration, this first communion service, and left singing a song and left for the garden. There was no benediction. So in lieu of a benediction, I give you the traditional blessing of Scripture. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
Hine, 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 Matov Manaim, Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat. Hine, 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 Matov Manaim, Shevet Ahim Gam Yahat.